Super.
Good morning, one and all. The topic for today's discussion will be grossing of bone lesions. And the objectives of the session will be to know the different types of bone specimens that we receive in a department.
Slightly louder, Saika.
Yes, sir. The gross features of various bone lesions will be discussed, and the grossing technique, how it is done, the steps of grossing, and a little about decalcification and the special studies also. For proper sections, this fixation and decalcification of the bone is very important. And a special mention about the special techniques, because we have to collect, in case we have to collect a specimen for special studies, they have to be done before decalcification itself. So what is the ideal time to collect special studies will also be discussed in brief. Now, coming to the different types of specimens. So these are the most commonly received specimen in our department. First is the total joint arthroplasty specimen, which is very common, and it is usually done for degenerative joint diseases. The next is the bone resection specimens, which is done for benign and malignant tumors. This is also quite common. And in addition to these, we also receive some bone biopsy and curetting specimens, mainly for the diagnosis of metabolic bone disease, some bone tumors, and even for osteonecrosis. So with this introduction, we go into the grossing of specimens. So grossing of bone specimens is quite different. In that we have fixation along with decalcification. So when we receive the specimen, first we'll discuss about the arthroplasty specimens, then we'll go into the resection specimens. So when we receive the arthroplasty specimens, we might receive them in fragments, or we might receive it along with the intact femoral head also. So the first step is to describe the number of fragments of the bone and the size, if they are in aggregates, the range and the extent should be measured. And also we should look for any recognizable portion of the bone, like the femoral head or the femoral contents, and we have to describe the articular surface. The next thing to describe is the number of fragments, the color and consistency of the soft tissue. So after describing it, then the bone is separated from the soft tissue, because in arthroplasty specimen we receive the bone along with the tissue and the cartilage, soft tissue and the cartilage. So after separating the soft tissue from the bone, one section of the soft tissue along with the synovium, which is the normal synovium, will look like a thin delicate membrane, should be submitted as one section. Now the bone which is separated from the soft tissue has to be fixed overnight in formalin, and it has to be decalcified the following day. So after decalcification, so this decalcification varies with the size of the specimen. So we have to periodically check. So details about that will be dealt at the end of the session. So after decalcification, we have to serially section through the decalcified bone, particularly when osteonecrosis is suspected. So the entire specimen must be serially sectioned. Why it is done is to look for the characteristic gross findings. So in case we receive a intact femoral head, so in that case, so the description, before description, let me tell you, this femoral head has to be cut into three parallel cuts. So along the long axis, and the central section should be at least 0.5 centimeter in width. So the thickness should be 0.5 centimeter. So while describing the femoral head, we have to describe the dimensions. What is the shape, the cartilage surface, whether it is smooth or there's any eburnation, fibrillation or any pannus formation, and the detachment of the cartilage is seen or not, which is seen in osteonecrosis, and any presence of exostosis should also be mentioned. After describing the specimen as a whole, we have to describe the quality of the bone, whether it is osteoporotic, sclerotic or pale, which is seen in metastatic diseases and also in metabolic bone diseases. Then we have to describe the resection margin and the articular margin. So the resection surface will be smooth and flat in its surgical, and if it is jagged and hemorrhagic, then a metastatic tumor has to be suspected. Then we have to describe the soft tissue, and we have to submit one cassette including the synovium if possible. Then this femoral head should also be fixed in formalin overnight and has to be decalcified the following day. So coming to the cassettes, So one cassette should include the soft tissue. If the grossly recognizable synovium is there, that soft tissue bit should also include the synovium. Then coming to the bone, so this bone section should include the junction of the normal and the abnormal, and one section should be taken from the periphery to rule out, since it's an arthroplasty specimen, this is usually done for degenerative joint disease, but unexpected conditions like rheumatoid arthritis and osteonecrosis can also happen. Therefore, one from the periphery has to be taken to rule out any pannus formation or exostosis also. So sometimes the bone specimens can have some crystal-like whitish deposits. So this may suggest a crystal disease like gout or chondrocalcinosis. So if crystals are present, then fixing and processing is quite different. So these crystals are easily dissolved. They are soluble in water. They'll be easily washed away. Therefore, we have to fix these crystal substances in absolute alcohol, and while processing also it has to be hand processed, and we have to request three stains. One is the HNE, regular HNE, and the other one is the right stain. So it's an anaqueous solution so that the crystals are well preserved in the stain, and one unstained stain slide can also be requested. Sometimes we can also directly smear these unfixed crystals onto the slide, and it can be directly visualized under the polarized light also. And if there is a fracture site, then two representative sections in one cassette from the fracture site can also be given. So this is about the crossing of arthroplasty specimens. So coming to the different types of lesions that can be seen. So first is about the avascular necrosis of the femur. So in avascular necrosis, what we see is this characteristic wedge-shaped pale yellow necrotic area, which is situated just below the cartilage surface. And this overlying cartilage will be separated from the bone. So this is to show a specimen of the femoral head. So in this specimen, we could see that there is a pale wedge-shaped yellowish area just below the cartilage, and the cartilage is also seen detached from the bone. So a similar picture to show the same findings. So in this condition, the section is given in such a way that both the avascular necrotic area along with the detached cartilage is submitted. So coming to the degenerative joint diseases like osteoarthritis, which are very common in our day-to-day grossing practice. So here, the changes are more common, and it starts in the cartilage. So the cartilage surface on the bone can show mild fibrillation, and there will be loss over the center of the femoral head in the initial stages. So when this exposed bone, when the bone is exposed after the loss of cartilage, it becomes more thickened, and it becomes very smooth like an ivory-like. So this process is called eburnation. We should also look for these eburnated areas on the exposed bone. The femoral head may be misshapen and flattened. Occasionally, bone spurs or osteophytes can be formed around the edge of the articular surface, while the soft tissue is relatively unaffected or fibrotic. So this is a specimen of knee arthroplasty in which the specimen is obtained in aggregates. So after description, we should look for areas of eburnation and erosion, so which is highly suggestive of osteoarthritis. So these are more pictures to show you the same thing. So here we have the femoral head. We could see a scanty residual cartilage as pinkish colored area. And here this cartilage shows mild fibrillation. So as the stage increases, we'll see that there is a loss of cartilage noted, and this shows a femoral head which has very less cartilage, and this is the final stage where there is no cartilage at all. So coming to rheumatoid arthritis, so the gross features of rheumatoid arthritis are similar to that of degenerative joint disease, but the characteristic findings of rheumatoid arthritis are the synovial changes. That is, the synovium will have hyperplastic growth over the cartilage surface, and there may be pannus formation. So this is the gross picture. This whitish area is a pannus overgrowth, and here we see the synovium. So this is again to show the synovial tissue having a papillary appearance in rheumatoid arthritis. And coming to gout, gout, they are more common in the small joints, and they are less common in long bones, but they can also happen there. So here There will be chalky white crystalline deposits grossly on the surface. So again, the synovium can become hyperplastic and it can also form a pannus. So the gross differential of gout is CPPD, pseudo gout or chondrocalcinosis. So it is very difficult to grossly identify these two lesions or to differentiate these two lesions. But there are some subtle clues that in calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate deposition disease, the crystals are usually seen within the cartilage, whereas in gout, the periarticular soft tissue of the small joints of foot and hand will have the crystals. So this is a gross image to show the chalky white crystalline deposits on the lower end of the femur, and this is a small bone to show that the chalky white deposits of uric acid. These are the uric acid crystals seen in gout. So again, what is important in the fixing and processing of these specimens is that the chalky deposits are easily soluble in water, so they should be fixed in 100% alcohol, and they have to be hand processed, and it can be directly smeared onto the slide and can be seen under the polarizing microscope. So with that, we have finished the grossing of arthroplasty specimens. Now coming to resection specimens. So resection specimens are routinely done for bone tumors, both benign and malignant. So this is a picture from Leicester to show the different lesions at different sides of the bone. So we have the diaphyseal, metaphyseal and the epiphyseal lesions. The diaphyseal lesions include Ewing sarcoma, lymphoma, osteofibrous dysplasia, adamantinoma, osteoastioma, fibrous dysplasia, and chondromyxoid fibroma. So the bone-forming lesions and some of the cartilage-forming lesions are more common in the metaphysis, which includes the osteoblastoma, osteochondroma, osteosarcoma, enchondroma, chondrosarcoma, even giant cell tumor, bone cysts, and osteoblastoma are more common in the metaphysis, whereas chondroblastoma is seen in the epiphysis. Now coming to the grossing of resection specimens. So first of all, we have to determine the type of the specimen. Sometimes we could also get amputation specimen. So we have to determine whether it is an below knee or above knee amputation. And we have to measure the dimension. So if it's an amputation specimen, the circumference of the limb and the length of the limb should also be measured. Then we have to radiograph the intact specimen that we have received. So the radiographic features are very important as such. So after we receive the specimen, it is we can also radiograph it, and this can be later correlated. And then the third step is to incise the soft tissue, and we have to bisect the specimen with the bone saw. So the use of instruments is also very important. We have to make sure that we use proper instrument to bisect the specimen so that the greatest extent of the tumor is well demonstrated. And even when we receive flat bones, so it is best to cut them into transverse sections. So after bisecting the tumor, we have to photograph the specimen. So this photographing of the specimen is very important for larger specimens like osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma. So in cases of osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma, the treatment, main modality of treatment is neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And so the diagnosis is usually, particularly in Ewing sarcoma, the biopsy itself is required to diagnose the disease. So after which the patient is immediately started on chemotherapy, and the resection is usually done to estimate the residual tumor or the treatment response. So in that case, we have to photograph the specimen and it can be later mapped. So we'll discuss about it in the later slides. So the specimen can be photographed as such, or for larger specimens like osteosarcoma, we have to make a 0.5 centimeter or 5 millimeter cut parallel to the exposed bone, and this has to be separately photographed. So after describing it, we have to come to the tube descriptions. It has to be described in the following heading. So first is the size. So the three dimensions of the tumor, the appearance, the color, the bone formation or the cartilage formation if present has to be noted. Then necrosis. Again, this becomes very important in post-treatment specimens. This necrosis is indicated as a percentage of the tumor. Then the location. So we had already discussed about the different locations of the bone tumors. And next is the relationship to the surrounding structures like other bones, the vessels, nerves and muscles. We should also look for the erosion of cortex, whether it has eroded the cortex and it has extended into the soft tissue, into the epiphyseal plate, or it has gone into or across the joint space. Also look for skip metastasis and distance from each margin. So after we have described the tumor, we have to take sections of the margin, particularly the soft tissue margin, before it is decalcified. And we should also carefully search for lymph nodes and submit it. Now the entire specimen, which is bisected, has to be fixed in formalin overnight, and then it has to be decalcified the next day. So the sections that are required for a resection specimen are mainly the tumor which is 1 section per centimeter of the tumor, the relationship of the tumor to the adjacent normal bone, if there is any invasion then that has to be given, and also the margins, which includes the soft tissue and the bone margins. In addition to these, any area of different radiological appearance or any other variegated appearance that is seen has to be sampled adequately, and this can be correlated with the radiograph which was taken before. So for osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma, the entire cross section of the tumor is mapped out and submitted. So the cassettes that we give are, first is the tumor, so which is at least 1 section per centimeter, showing the relationship of the tumor with the cortex, medulla, adjacent joint and the soft tissue. The margin will include the soft tissue and bone margin, normal structure if they are present, representative sections of the normal structure should be given, and also all the lymph nodes that we have found. So in post treatment resection specimens, we have to, as mentioned, we have to map them and they have to be blocked out. So the additional blocks which are to be given are from should be taken perpendicular to the cross section to determine the extent, and also blocks from less susceptible areas to chemotherapy, like the soft tissue extension, the pericartilaginous areas, the subcortical marrow, the cortex. These are all some of the areas which are less susceptible to chemotherapy. So if this is an osteosarcoma of the lower end of femur, the sections to be given are the tumor bits, that is one section per centimeter, the tumor with the adjacent bone, then the margins, the bony cut margin, the soft tissue margin, and if there is any extension into the soft tissue, a bit from there has to be submitted. So in this particular specimen, there is a skip lesion, so sample from that area, and also the adjacent articular cartilage, if recognized, can we also be given as one more section. So coming to the lesions, so for easier discussion, we'll divide them into bone forming, bone cyst, fibrosis lesions. So bone forming lesions can be benign, malignant. So the benign lesions are osteoma, osteodysteoma, osteoblastoma, and osteosarcoma is malignant. So in bone cysts, we have unicarmal bone cyst and aneurysmal bone cyst. The fibrosis lesions include fibrous dysplasia, osteofibrous dysplasia. The cartilage forming lesions include the benign lesions, osteochondroma, enchondroma, chondroblastoma, and chondromyxoid fibroma, whereas the malignant lesion is the chondrosarcoma and its variants. We have the giant cell lesion, the other less commonly received specimen are cardoma, fibrous tumors like non-ossifying fibroma and fibrosarcoma. In addition to this, we'll also discuss about Ewing sarcoma, LCH, and adamantinoma. So also we should know something about these metastatic lesions, because the bone is the most common tumors in the malignant lesions in the bone are metastatic lesions. So we'll also have a small touch up on the gross findings of metastatic lesions to the bone. So coming to the benign bone-forming lesions, osteoma, which is a well-circumscribed sessile polypoidal lesion. This is usually found in the flat bones of the craniofacial skeleton. And they have a smooth bosselated surface. So this is from the skull bone. And there is a sessile semicircular shaped bony mass with a median size of 3 cm. So coming to osteosarcoma, so osteosarcoma and osteoblastoma are closely related lesions, and they are different mainly in their size. So when the lesion is less than 2 cm, it is an osteosarcoma. So it is usually a bright pink or a red nodule with a gritty or granular lesion surrounded by a sclerotic bone. So if we radiograph the specimen, the characteristic central lucent zone can be seen, which is a nidus, and there it will be surrounded by a peripheral sclerotic reaction or a dense bone. So this is a gross image of an osteoid osteoma. So coming to osteoblastoma, so these are larger than osteoid osteoma. So they are more than 2 cm in size. They are well demarcated lesions with scalloped edges. They might be red or tan lesions due to hemorrhage. So this bone expansion may cause cortical thinning and surrounding sclerosis. Occasionally, we might also find one or more nidus. Now coming to osteosarcoma, which is a very important lesion. So this is a destructive bone forming tumor which can invade through the cortex into the adjacent soft tissue as shown in the picture, and it can also replace the entire medullary cavity or marrow space with the neoplastic tissue. So these are more images to show the gross findings of osteosarcoma. So the first is from a distal femur, the next is from a proximal humerus, and the next is from femur. So all the three lesions show that they extend into the soft tissue and they cause elevation of the periosteum, which is very characteristic of osteosarcoma. Now coming to the mapping which I was talking about earlier. So this is how a mapping of osteosarcoma specimen has to be done. So this figure is to show this is the tumor, and this is usually done for post chemotherapy specimen to microscopically examine the amount of viable tumor cells or the percentage of necrosis. So let's assume that this is the tumor and this is the bone. So we have to first, after cutting, bisecting and cutting open the specimen, a thin slice of 5 millimeter has to be again cut parallel to the section which was already described. And after that, we have to photograph this particular section, or it can be also made into a diagram, and vertical and horizontal lines are made to form numerous grids. And these grids are numbered from 1 to whatever number it can accommodate. From the uninvolved area to the whole specimen has to be mapped out like this, including the articular cartilage. So after it is mapped out, the similar cuts are similar blocks are made out in the specimen. So this is the thin slice of the bivalve specimen. So after mapping it in a diagram or a photograph, it is then cut into the original specimen, and this is again to show an intact osteosarcoma specimen and the one after mapped and blocked. So this is mainly to look at the treatment response. So this is done microscopically and it is graded into 4 groups. So grade 1 means when there is less than 50% necrosis, 51 to 89% is 2, more than 90 but less than 100 is, that is up to 99 is grade 3, grade 4 is 100% necrosis or no viable tumor and it has the best prognosis. So these are some of the variants of osteosarcoma to show the periosteal, which arises from the surface, and the central low grade osteosarcoma. So this is a picture of a telangiectatic osteosarcoma, which is located in the lower end of femur. So it has greater vascularity and also hemorrhagic areas throughout. So coming to the cystic lesions of the bone, a simple bone cyst can also be resected, and it is usually unilocular but can also be multilocular, and we identify it grossly by the thin smooth layer of fibrous tissue which contain serous and serosanguinous fluid. So here we see the gross appearance of a cyst of a simple cyst of bone. So coming to aneurysmal bone cyst, so it is a multilocated lesion with many blood-filled spaces. So these cystic spaces are separated by thin septa, fibrous septa, and the cyst usually contains a brown fibrous tissue with or without blood clots. So the most closest DD is the telangiectatic variant of osteosarcoma. So extensive sampling of the specimen has to be done to rule out any osteosarcoma and bone formation. So coming to the fibrous lesions, fibrous dysplasia. So this is an image of the fibrous dysplasia of the rib. So this is a fusiform expansion of the bone causing thinning of the cortex. So the entire area is replaced by firm gritty white or gray white tissue, and occasionally there may be a fracture site throughout the lesion. Now coming to the cartilaginous lesions of the bone, the benign lesions to start with, we have the osteochondroma, which is the one of the most commonly seen specimens in our grossing station. So these this is grossly like mushroom shaped periosteal projection, or it is also called as an exostosis from the bone surface. So the bone will be covered by a thick cartilaginous cap, and the thickness has to be measured. So it is measured in perpendicular to the bone cartilage interface at the thickest portion, and a thick irregular cap of more than 2 centimeters is an indication of progression, and a peripheral chondrosarcoma can also arise later from the cartilaginous cap. So this is another gross picture to show the thickened cartilaginous cap in an osteochondromatous lesion. So coming to the next benign lesion, enchondromas. So these are intramedullary cartilaginous neoplasms. So what we see here is they have a lobulated appearance of multiple, they are multiply lobulated lesions which are filled with cartilage. So here in this picture we can see that they are a whitish blue glistening inside the medullary cavity with an intact cortex. Coming to chondroblastoma, they are well-defined eccentric lesions with a thin sclerotic rim. So in consistency, they may be soft to rubbery with a gritty feel, and sometimes they may be associated with hemorrhagic areas, and a chondroid matrix can be seen. So coming to chondromyxoid fibroma, so these are lesions with well-defined margins. So in the picture, you can see that this is a firm. It's a lobulated tumor which has this yellow or grayish yellow appearance, and they do have scalloped margins. So coming to the malignant cartilage forming tumor, chondrosarcoma, so they are usually they have ill-defined margins with cortical destruction, and they have this lobulated growth pattern. So in the picture we could see that they have this translucent grayish white areas, and here there is a cortical erosion, and sometimes these chondrosarcoma can be calcified. When they calcify, they might have this yellowish white or chalky appearance. Areas of necrosis can also be seen in such specimens. Now coming to the next lesion, the giant cell tumor. So giant cell tumor usually have a variegated appearance with hemorrhage and necrosis. So they are usually asymmetrically expanded. The surrounding cortex is usually thinned out and may be destroyed. So they have this variegated, soft, friable, tan, red to yellow appearance with areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. So these are more pictures to show the gross appearance of the giant cell tumor of bone. So in the first picture, we could see that they have hemorrhagic areas which are characteristically reddish brown, and complication of pathological fracture is also seen in the first specimen. In the second specimen, we could see that they have cystic lesions with yellowish areas, and these tumors are locally aggressive lesions, so they can also destroy the bone and the soft tissue as shown in this picture. So coming to the other common lesions of bone that we see. So a chordoma, which is usually seen in the sacrococcygeal location, is a solid lobular mass with a gelatinous appearance, which can be appreciated in this picture. So they have a mucoid gelatinous appearance, and these are also lesions which can destroy the bone and extend into the surrounding soft tissue. Coming to non-ossifying fibroma, they are well-circumscribed lesions. They may have this granular or dark reddish-brown areas. They have sclerotic borders, and occasional cystic change in hemorrhagic areas can be seen. So the malignant fibrous tumor is a fibrosarcoma, which has trabeculated cut white surface with firm consistency, and they are usually well circumscribed, and if this is a high grade lesion, they may show a fleshy appearance. So now coming to Ewing sarcoma, so the grossing of Ewing sarcoma is similar to that of osteosarcoma, in that we have to photograph the specimen, map it, block it, and then give it for histological examination, so that whatever findings is seen can be correlated with the picture, so the blocks can be easily correlated. Here the tumor is usually having an indistinct border. So this is a Ewing sarcoma in the fibula. So they are gray-white lesions with indistinct borders. They may have areas of hemorrhage, cystic degeneration, and necrosis. They are usually destroying the adjacent bone, which is next to it, is usually destroyed by these tumors. And this is another picture to show the Ewing sarcoma that has arisen from the lower femur with the elevation of periosteum. So again, here the treatment response is graded microscopically. So grade 1 is when there is a macroscopic viable tumor. When there is only a microscopic viable tumor, it's grade 2, and grade 3 is no viable tumor, and it carries the best prognosis. So coming to adamantinoma, so they are poorly defined lobulated lesions with whitish gray gritty peripheral sclerosis as shown here. So they vary in size from 1 to 10 centimeters. So depending on the size, so if they are very large, they may cause cortical breakthrough, intramedullary extension, and even soft tissue invasion. So these are some of the less commonly seen specimen in the grossing station, but I thought I'll just show you the features. So this is the first picture is to show a plasmacytoma in the head of the femur, where the lesion is just below the cartilage with adjacent areas of hemorrhage. And this is a picture to show myeloma, where we see round lytic lesions on the inner aspect of the skull. Then coming to Langer and Cell histiocytosis, so they do not have a characteristic gross appearance, but they might be fleshy masses that will almost destroy the bone. So here it arises from a rib, and it's a fleshy mass destroying the rib. And small thing about the metabolic disease of bone. So this is a gross image of an osteoporosis of vertebra. So here we could see this paucity of bony spicules, and this is another metabolic disease, osteopetrosis. So this is a disease characterized by defective osteoclastic function. So there will be abnormally dense bone, which can be seen in these pictures. And Paget's disease, which is characterized by increased bone turnover, and there will be a compensatory bone formation. So there is a cortical thickening and coarsening of the trabeculae, which is seen in this picture. So now coming to the metastatic lesions of the bone. So these metastasis can be seen as hemorrhagic or friable tissue, particularly if they are from thyroid or kidney. If the metastasis is from prostate and breast, they will be very hard in gross examination due to reactive bone formation, and melanoma can produce dark pigmented metastasis. So the first picture is a metastatic lesion from renal cell carcinoma. So here we see that it is somewhat hemorrhagic and friable. The second picture is to show the metastatic deposits from a myeloma lesion. So this is a picture of the femur to show infiltration of acute myeloid leukemia. So here we see that it is entirely replaced by the infiltrated tumor. And this is an example of metastatic chondrosarcoma in the foot. So another picture to show the osteolytic secondary deposits from breast carcinoma in the vertebral bodies. And these metastatic carcinomas can produce the pathological fracture of ribs. So now coming to decalcification, so the sections that we give, the quality of the sections data is determined mainly by the fixation and decalcification. So if it's over decalcified or under decalcified, then the morphology is greatly altered. So therefore, some protocols have been followed for the decalcification of small and larger bony bits. So for small sized bony bits like the bone marrow biopsy, the curetta specimen, or small bone biopsies, the specimen is fixed in formalin and it is then decalcified for 4 to 12 hours with periodic checks. If it's a larger and harder bony bit, then they are it is preferable to cut them into section which can be accommodated, and then they can be fixed overnight, and then they have to be gently decalcified with periodic checks. And if it's very firm tissue and which are less calcified, so they can be put for overnight fixation, and this will in 10% buffered formalin. So this will be this can cause simultaneous fixation and decalcification. So if required, they can further be decalcified with 5% nitric acid solution for 5 to 6 hours. So every time we have to check whether the decalcification process is complete. So this endpoint is determined either by a physical method, a chemical method, or a radiographic method. So the physical method is the most commonly employed one, where the bone is taken out, it is slightly bent, or a pin is introduced to see whether it has decalcified properly. And radiographic method includes radiographing the specimen before and after decalcification. And sometimes we can use chemical methods, but this is not generally used routinely. We can use a decalcifying agent with a mixture of ammonium hydroxide and ammonium oxalate. So the final topic, the special studies. So this is special studies is given importance in bone lesions, because these specimens have to be collected before decalcification. So we had already seen about the crystal disease, the uric acid crystals, and calcium pyrophosphate iodide crystal deposition disease. So these crystals has to be fixed in absolute alcohol and processed with manually. So if we see it under the polarizing microscopy, the uric acid crystals are needle shaped, negatively birefringent and yellow, whereas CPPD crystals are rhomboid, positively birefringent and less bright or blue. So calcium oxalate crystals can be seen, which are usually needle shaped, and they are also refractive and polarizable. In addition, these crystals can also be identified using chemical analysis, X-ray diffraction or electron diffraction. So coming to metastatic disease. So now metastatic disease is usually seen as a pathological fracture, which can be seen clinically or grossly. So the first step, whenever we do not know the primary site, so the first thing we have to do is we have to take the tissue for special studies. So if we decalcify it, we might not get good samples for special studies. So we have to take it before decalcifying, and this can be snap frozen or can be kept for EMs. So these soft tissues has to be separated out from the bone, and they have to be submitted separately. So in case if it is decalcified, this will affect some of the antigens, particularly when we have to do IHCs, these antigens are affected and we do not get desirable results. So coming to the metabolic disease, even in metabolic disease, we have to give sectioning from the non-decalcified bone for special studies and morphometry. However, we do not do it routinely. These techniques are generally performed by a specialty laboratory. So this is about the grossing of bone lesions. Thank you.
Thank you, Faika. That was a very good presentation. You covered most of the points.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Moving on to the question, please.
Very nice. Very nice.
The first question, can Madhumita take it?
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Madhu.
Ma'am?
Yes, Madhu.
Yes, ma'am. I think it's bone. There is a central lesion which is chalky white. Dirty crystals are seen in the center part, ma'am. So if they go, the important precaution is it has to be saved in the absolute alcohol, ma'am, because it's soluble in aqueous solution. And it has, the staining has to be done by the hand staining, and it is in a right staining. Hand processing and right staining.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so one question, Madhu. If I want to see the crystals, how do I see? Your answer
to see it in the ma'am. Polarizing microscope, you have to see, ma'am. What
precaution should I, what should I do to, if I want to see the crystals, you know, and what are the other methods I can adopt to see the crystals? Aisha, can you help her out?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, these are refractile, ma'am. So we can increase the contrast by lowering the condenser or so that they become more brighter and shinier, ma'am. Or we can use polarizing filters, ma'am.
Ika, you tell the first direct smearing. That is very, very
yes,
important.
Sir,
you
sir.
Told it can be done. It has to be done. And
yes, sir.
You
yes,
know,
sir.
Water should not come into contact with anything. It's water soluble. Okay,
yes,
direct
sir, yes,
smear.
Sir.
Don't do anything. No cover slipping and all. Just take it under the polarizing microscope.
Yes, okay? Yes, sir.
Direct smear and polarizing microscope, avoiding the water, is very important for gout.
Yes, yes.
Probably Archana may be asking that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So basically, for taking the and having unstained sections to visualize these crystals. Yes. Okay, good. So move on to the next question. Can some first year answer?
Shivaranjani. Name somebody, otherwise nobody will answer.
Shivaranjani is there.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes, Shivaranjani.
Yes, ma'am. Osteosarcoma, ma'am. Metaphysis. Site only, no, ma'am.
Yes, yes, go ahead. Yes, go ahead. Then what else? Yes.
Giant cell tumor.
Are you sure? Giant
wrong.
Bone cyst, ma'am.
Okay.
Osteoblastoma.
Okay.
And then osteosarcoma.
So you have given me three. You have given me osteosarcoma, bone cyst, or osteoblastoma. One more.
Sivaranjini, tell one more osteosarcoma, madam.
Sir.
Na padam enga ma padatha kaiyila edunga.
Yes sir, sir. Osteochondroma.
Okay.
Which include bone forming lesions like osteoblastoma, osteochondroma, osteosarcoma, enchondromas and chondrosarcomas are cartilaginous lesion. Sometimes a giant cell lesion can happen. In addition, we have to remember bone cyst and non-ossifying fibroma. Next
like
question
is giant cell lesion.
Yes, sir.
Is endophysial lesion.
Epiphyseal.
Okay?
Epiphyseal.
Okay. But anything can happen anywhere. But in the exam, you should not say giant cell tumor in the metaphysis.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Say epiphysis.
Yes, sir. Identify this lesion.
Some second year, maybe Anirudh. Anirudh? Are you there?
Anirudh, where are you?
Okay. Alternatively, is Josephine there?
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Josephine.
Ma'am, this lesion is an osteoid osteoma, less than 2 cm in size. It can appear as a pink or a reddish nodule. It is a gritty or granular surrounded by sclerotic nidus.
Yes, very good, Josephine. What is the characteristic?
This is a case of osteoid osteoma.
What is the characteristic history that the patient can come with, Josephine, with osteoid osteoma?
Ma'am, pain at night, ma'am. Characteristically woken up during night by pain, ma'am. It is relieved on taking aspirin.
Okay, very good. Very good. Okay.
The next question is grading system for microscopic evaluation of post-treatment osteosarcoma.
So, Paul, can you take up this question?
Hello?
Yes, Paul.
Hello, yes, ma'am. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Grading system is to be done for osteosarcoma post chemotherapy. So it is based upon the percentage of necrosis. So grade 1, we have less than 50% of necrosis. Grade 2 is 51 to 89. Then grade 3 is 90 to 99. And grade 4 is there is 100% necrosis. There is no viable tumor cell seen.
Yes, ma'am. So it's 4 grades and he has given the percentage. A final question. Identify and describe the lesion.
So second year, so Suman, can you take up this question?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Suman.
Ma'am, so this is an intramedullary lesion, ma'am. We can see that there are multiple lobules of this grayish blue nodules are present within the medulla, and surrounding the bone is intact, ma'am. So this could be an enchondroma.
Yes, ma'am, it's an enchondroma. It's an intramedullary lesion with multiple lobules of cartilage within the bone. These are my references. Thank you.
Very good presentation, Faika, and all of you have answered well. Just one question for Faika. Can I ask
you? Yes, ma'am.
So, Faika, you mentioned about some ancillary tests which can be done in tumors. So, what kind of ancillary tests can be done in bone tumors? And in which conditions we cannot perform those tests?
Ma'am, the ancillary testing can for if the if there is a metastatic tumor, ma'am. So when the we are suspecting a metastasis, so in that case the IHC can be performed. Even cytogenetics can be performed, ma'am. Yes. In cases of Ewing sarcoma and PNETs, we can do it.
Yes.
So
in which condition we cannot do the cytogenetic study? So we should not.
Yeah. Ma'am, if it's a post treatment when yes. it's necrosed, in that case we cannot perform it.
Yes, very good. So if it is treated, we cannot do it. Good, Taika.
Yes, ma'am. Thank okay. you, ma'am.
And for the first years, when you receive a specimen of the bone, so can somebody tell me, say, Emmanuel, can you tell me, do I need to decalcify it first, or do I need to fix it first? How do I manage a specimen when now you are alone in the grossing station and you get a bone? So what will you do first, Emmanuel?
Good morning, ma'am.
Emmanuel.
We first need to fix it before going for decal, ma'am.
Yes, very good. That is a very important step. So you fix it overnight and then go on for decal. Oh, very yes. good. Ma'am, anybody has, sir, ma'am, any questions from your end?
Very good presentation, Taika. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Few things I want to stress. Always remember CT scan radiology. Now they are stressing even before doing the grossing, you have to see them. Then only you will know how to gross, especially in resection specimens. Okay, so radiology is gross part one. What we see the specimen is gross for part two. That you all have to remember in almost all the cases, even mammogram, radiology you have to see. That is, radiology is now considered as part of grossing. It is number one. Number two, you told metastatic carcinoma femoral head will be irregular. Why it is irregular? Or you told when the femoral head is irregular, it is metastatic.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's because the tumor will produce some soluble particles which will erode the bone. That gives it somewhat jagged and irregular appearance.
It is fracture. Okay. So the tumor causes fracture because it's very weak, no? And femoral neck is the major impact. We all carry our weight on femoral neck. So it's a fracture. So fractured femoral neck can have irregular margin. Whereas when they surgically remove it for osteoarthritis, it will be a flat margin. Okay?
Yes,
that is number two. Number three, how will you do frozen section in when you get the bone tumor? They want to know what is the tumor. Lastly.
Yes, sir.
You cannot, if there is soft tissue, you just feel it. If there is any soft tissue, pick up the soft tissue and give it a frozen section.
Okay,
or
sir,
you
okay,
do
sir.
A touch probe or scrape. We cannot freeze the bone. You have to
okay, sir, okay,
to the surgeon, but you try to help him by preparing a touch preparation or scrape preparation or frozen section of the soft tissue.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
My last most important question is, how will you give a bone margin for osteosarcoma or any bone tumor? How will you deal with the margin?
So we have
is it possible to give a shave margin of a bone?
Scoop margin.
Yes, marrow scoop margin. Okay, the bone tumor has never spread through cortical bone, so there is no need for giving a, and it will take time if you want to give a shave margin of the bone, so you have to give a scoop margin.
Yes,
and lastly, there are types of saws available. You forget to mention what are all the types of saws available to cut the bones. That is very useful, because you may end up with a hospital where they do a lot of bone tumors. We don't do that many bone tumors. So you have to know what are all the types of saws. Just put that in the WhatsApp group.
Super,
Faika. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Very nice, Faika. Prachna, can I just ask a few things?
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
So Faika, very nice presentation and a lot of
thank you, ma'am.
Important points which Dr. Rajendran sir has already mentioned. I wanted to ask that thing, that instrumentation part is extremely important in bone lesions. So supposing you're not able to cut, on what are the instrument, at least just mention one or two instruments that you usually use for bone lesions, Faika, since we are talking about crossing.
Ma'am, we use the bone saw, ma'am, that is what is routinely used.
Ma'am, supposing you're not able to cut with the bone saw. Supposing you do not have the thing enough to cut with the regular saw that is available in our crossing station, what would you do then, Faika?
Ma'am, we can use the instruments that we have in the FM, the pliers, and
so that's why. So it's very important. Please mention,
Yes, ma'am.
Not in FM, like anatomy.
Yes, sir.
It's anatomy.
Okay.
So just write down the instruments because that's very important. I think you should not sweat it out by trying to think that that's the only thing. There are methods to help you when you are not able to cut. Then second thing is there are something called immobilization techniques, Faika, while doing bone crossing. Could you get that? Yeah. What do you mean by those immobilization techniques are important while doing bone crossing?
Ma'am, the thing is immobilization is to fix it, ma'am, while cutting. It should not move, ma'am. And for that, we have instruments also.
More important than bone lesions, yes. Is it more important while doing bone lesions?
Yes, ma'am. Because while we cut these bony small bits can interfere with the microtomy and also during tissue examination, ma'am. So it's important that we immobilize it to reduce all these artifacts caused by these small bony bits. That's why this immobilization is very important.
Can you just again in WhatsApp, please mention what are the immobilization, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And regarding orientation of bone specimens.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
So supposing you get a specimen where it is difficult to orient, Faika, what are the things that you would use to kind of guide you?
Ma'am, again, we should look for any recognizable portion, like any condyles is visible or any femoral head is visible. That is one thing, ma'am. Then we should, again, in doubt, we can call the surgeon to orient it for us when in doubt, when you're not able to identify such anatomical landmarks or something like that. We can call the surgeon to orient it for us.
Okay. So again, there are a couple of more things which you can mention. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
For completion, right? And also, please mention if there are some wrong practices that happens, particularly with bone crossing. Okay, Faika, because many times we ourselves are very confused as to how to approach bone. So sometimes, you know, as for example, the margins, you know, it is definitely a maroscope margin. So certain wrong practices happens, and that you should know to how to avoid these wrong practices. Because we are discussing purely crossing. So please just look up some wrong practices which happen because lack of knowledge and lack of this thing. So that also you'll have to kind of give an idea.
Yes,
and regarding how to, how to know whether the bone is decalcified, that's a very, very important question, very frequently asked question. And I want all first years, final years and second years to know that. It's a very frequent question and unfortunately not a very well answered question also. So please make sure that you know how to do it, how it is done in your institution. What if it is a big chunk of bone? What if it's a tiny chunk of bone? How do you make out with the decalcification? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Archana. Very nicely moderated. And Faika, very, very nice.
Ma'am, can I make a point? Archana, can I add a point here?
Please, ma'am. Please.
Yeah.
The thing is, ma'am, it was very well presented, I felt, because we really face a lot of difficulty where I've heard that, you know, the entire amputated leg was put in decalcifying solution. So I think Faika has very clearly explained very how we have to cut it, slice it, and then take a small piece and put in decalcifying solution. So yes. The practical difficulty is that, you know, we feel lazy about taking it to the anatomy department. And then so that is the part where assistants and PGs were there in grossing have to be very careful that, you know, you cut it and then only put Yes. The whole amputated leg will take years to decalcify.
And it doesn't make any sense to put the entire thing in fixation.
Yes,
right?
Yes, ma'am.
Important point.
And one more thing is, what are rice bodies? We have seen that also in grossing. Can somebody tell me what are rice bodies?
Elena, mention a name. Dr. Elena, just
okay,
mention
ma'am.
A name, please.
Yeah. Kundavai, what are rice bodies? Is Kundavai there?
Hello ma'am.
Yes, Kundavai, yes, you're right.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Yes. Yes. Mind up. Something you get something along with the phone. Aika, if you get things along with the phone, what is to be done?
Madam, first part of your question is not.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
First part of your question is not.
Not heard. Okay. If you get teeth along with the bone. Aika, what
yes,
will you do?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, in that case, we should look for any attached soft tissue with that teeth, ma'am.
Very good.
And that has to be sampled.
Teeth you will not.
Very hard.
Try and do anything.
And you have diamond blades to cut the teeth. So that also you have to remember. We can cut bone and heart tissue even without decal with more harder blades.
Okay.
Faika, put some reference for that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Super, Faika.
I have seen people waiting for that in a spoof margin, so you need not say spoof margin to be given, because we should remember that.
For amputated specimen, as the Bharati madam told, in addition to osteomyelitis, look for ischemic changes. And if it is below knee amputation, you have to give the resection margin of the blood vessels. That is very, very important. Okay. The margin should be vascular margin, skin and soft tissue margin, bone scoop margin. So these are all the three margins you have to remember for below knee amputation. Super.
Very nice, excellent.
Breaking, madam, breaking.
That
இருக்கு.